it's fun to be with a group to talk about this subject, as opposed to having to work at this subject for an hour or so, because that's where I spend almost all of my time nowadays, is working on very sensitive issues where this question kind of becomes paramount. I was on a phone with an attorney this morning relative to a labor negotiation. I'm going to give you a little insight into that and how this idea of transparency kind of finds its way everywhere. I would suggest, especially because it's such an intimate group and you guys know more of what you're looking for out of this conversation even than I know what you're looking for, is let's do just that. So I've got some slides to kind of frame a bit of a discussion, but I'd suggest throw your hand up, let's shout out something, let's get into the conversation as we go along and not wait till the end. Okay, does that sound fair? So transparency, everybody wants it, and we all want it to protect ourselves from anything and everything that might be at risk to us, especially. If you think about a year ago, what happened at Chipotle, which is still my daughter who teaches in Baltimore, still her absolute favorite place in the world. This didn't shake that at all. But if you think back to the events of what happened at Chipotle, and if you were to look at the timeline from when they first discovered what they thought might be a problem to when they actually called it an outbreak and did something much more public about it, there was a couple, 3 weeks. And I actually have students down at Newhouse that have done case studies in detail about what they did or didn't do during that 2 or 3 week period of time. Now, we would all know and certainly understand, certainly from the work I do, I know that things are complicated. And it's quite often difficult to say on day one that we've got this problem before we even fully understand what the problem was. However, there are certain limits to how long we think we should push that envelope of kind of being quiet and determining when we should open our mouths. And this particular example is probably one that has even more health and safety risks associated with it, because if you look at its timeline, you're looking at well over a year and a half before things really became known and the widespread basis upon which things... Hi. Come right in, wherever you're comfortable. So to me, that begs the question of transparency. How much? How often? To what degree? And there's more to meet the eye sometimes than just a health issue. This particular case that I wanted to talk to you about this morning, and I've got 5 or 6 of these in different venues, but I thought this one might be interesting to you. A manufacturing plant, 100 years old, been in business for 100 years. I won't go into the detail of what the products they make are because they're so specialized that you probably would start to be able to figure them out with a little bit of Google. Let's just suffice it to say that the products that this organization makes are in coffee pots, plumbing supply fixtures, the space shuttle, you know, aircraft of every kind, and they're that basic and fundamental. They've been around 100 years. Now, the one little hint is one of the issues that this organization had to deal with about 20 or 30 years ago was many of the products that they made were made of asbestos. And that in and of itself began to become a major, major concern. Just turn on TV any night at 1 o'clock in the morning if you're having trouble sleeping, and what you'll hear is a lawyer's ad for, have you or a member of your family experienced mesothelioma, asbestosis? Call this number. This particular company alone has about $10 billion in insurance reserves associated with mesothelioma. But that's not the issue at hand. Manufacturing, as a general rule in this country, has suffered over the years as we've shipped things overseas. This particular company was struggling financially to find the right customers, to have enough work, to keep their plants open in the United States. And in particular, right now, they're going through union negotiations. Now, their union negotiations right now are early enough on in the cycle that they're not on strike. This was taken several years ago when they were on strike and I was working with the company. However, one of the dilemmas that the company is facing right now is that they have a suitor, someone who's very interested in them, from India, who wants to buy the company. And any good management team would not be responsible. Any good board of directors would not be responsible from a fiscal and fiduciary standpoint if they didn't entertain those conversations. So they are entertaining those conversations. And as the union negotiations gear up, one of the things that we find ourselves surmising, which was the subject of the phone call this morning for an hour and a half, is do you tell the union that there's a chance that the company could be sold and everything picked up and moved to India? Now, this particular development didn't occur just in the last couple of weeks. But a couple of weeks ago, we had a different president, too. So this organization is struggling in very real time with how much to say to whom. And I just sort of let's park that there for a moment. I've got another client out in the West Coast who has a hospital board. This is a very unusual one because this happens to be a public hospital. So there's a public board, a municipal board, if you will, that oversees this hospital. Bless you. And this particular hospital, the board, has made some difficult decisions over the last few years. They've had four CEOs in 3 years. They've had two CFOs in 3 years. No one's been carted off in handcuffs. No one has been committing crimes, but the organization has a $4 million hole that they're trying to climb out of, and this is a very small hospital. In addition to that, they've got a rising need population that they're trying to figure out how to address with limited funds. And so in the middle of this, the residents of this municipal district have decided to recall the election of their board because they don't think their board is being responsive enough. And the question becomes then, how much gets disclosed? Because when a board of any organization meets to discuss very sensitive things, some of those meetings are held in what's called executive session. So in other words, if we were all the board of an organization here, but Miguel and Eric and Christine and Lou, if I'm getting this right, and
Sabian,
were our executive committee, it's quite possible that they would have had conversations that were off the record and not publicized that even the rest of the board would be fully aware of. That's very commonplace. And yet, this idea of transparency gets challenged. So right now in this community, there is an uprising, if you will, an uprising among the community to demand more transparency, to demand that this executive board be more forthcoming. The question comes, how transparent should we be? And I will admit to you that some people think I have long ago gone to the dark side. Because when I started my public relations practice, I spent 25 years working for organizations like Loretto. I was their facilities director for all their properties here in Syracuse. I worked for the Hartford Insurance Company, a Fortune 500 company that had businesses all over the country. I worked on the East Coast. And then ultimately ended up at a company called Agway. Some of you might know that name, Agway. Had a bunch of different jobs and ultimately was vice president of the company. And while I was there, we often, many times, would face the issue of how transparent should we be. When I started our own public relations practice, that dilemma became both a crutch, if you will, that stood in the way of us doing some of the work we needed to do, but I also decided it also could become one of the biggest differentiators for us. And so every client that we worked with, we would work with their legal counsel. And we decided to separate ourselves and sort of set ourselves aside, that we were the company that people would come to when they had to deal with very sensitive, knotty, difficult issues. I didn't care so much about helping somebody when they were opening a new business or hiring a new manager. I wanted to know when they were dealing with the most difficult situations that they had to face. And this question now for the last 20 or so years has been pretty much where I live every day. I'll give you one other example as we kind of launch into a few points I want to make and then open it up for more discussion. August 4th, 2011, I got a phone call from wasn't a client at the time, became a client, a gentleman in Long Island who owned a family-owned propane business. Propane is a fuel that's usually put into tanks. Some of you that might have either rural properties or second homes or camp properties, or depending on where you live, propane is a pretty important fuel source. Well, this particular company in Long Island supplied propane to 5,000 customers. The gentleman, we'll call him John, was third generation. His grandfather started the company, actually as a coal business that then sold oil and then sold propane. And John called me that morning at 7 a.m. to tell me about a terrific fire and explosion that had occurred that morning at 4 o'clock. This is the home. And this particular home was involved in a fire and ultimately an explosion, which resulted in this. Now, I'll spare you most of the details, but his first comment to me, now this is a small businessman who is very much involved and embedded in his community, president of his local chamber of commerce, on his local school board, has grandchildren that go to school nearby, very, very much, and he owned the business, so it was all right out of his wallet. He was calling me at 7 o'clock to say that this event had occurred and he needed a press release. And I assessed a few things that were going on. I said, well, John, why do you need a press release? He said, well, because this thing has happened and certainly we're going to be in the news. I said, well, wait a minute. Let's look at the news stories that were out there. And miraculously, although this was widely reported on Long Island, and by the way, within 24 hours among 970 other news outlets across the country because of some of the facts that came out, his company name was never, ever mentioned. Even after a few hours when the fire investigators just beginning to look through what might have happened, and it takes a long time to figure out what really happened, came to the conclusion that if propane didn't start it, it certainly had something to do with it because it's a fuel source. Much like gasoline or fuel oil or just wood would be. So he was sort of surprised at my suggestion that he not issue a news release. And he said, we probably should get my attorney on the phone, which I said, absolutely, because I don't like to do anything without counsel. So it's usually a triumvirate that deals with things. Got his attorney on the phone an hour later, talked through the situation. His attorney agreed with me. No news release. Not yet. Yet John was going crazy inside. His stomach was getting stirred up because he wanted to do something. He felt like he wanted to do something to say, I'm doing everything, I'm here, we will be here. And yet we advised him not to. To not be transparent, if you will. And as the events of the day unfolded, his company name never was put into the news. It was later learned that the mom was in the hospital in ICU. Dad was in the hospital, got released. But the real sad news was that there was an 18-month-old baby that could not be found. In fact, the remains of that child weren't found for about 3 days. And still we said, be quiet. Have statements ready. Talk to your employees. Don't be dishonest about it. But hold back. Well, why do you think we would say hold back?
I actually have a question more
sure.
than an answer. So was it clear in the end that the explosion was because of the products of the company or not?
No.
Or was it ambiguous?
Not, but it took 4 weeks to determine what the real cause of the fire was. And when I say cause of the fire, where the ignition point was, because the propane, in fact, did contribute to it, only because it was a fuel source.
Okay, so in a sense, the product of the company was not the cause of
the explosion.
Something else triggered an explosion that was then amplified by the propane.
Right, but nobody knew that day one, day two, day five, day 10. Didn't know.
Okay.
Hi.
I would say don't incriminate yourself before it's clear where the accountability falls. And also, because of the tendency of the media to thrive on information that is salacious and allocates blame to some party. They like to, and also storytelling. And lately I've heard a lot about the Hollywood concept of storytelling. We want to be able to have this resolution about who's responsible.
Right.
So all of those factors combined, it just doesn't make sense.
And if you put yourself, thank you, and if you put yourself in John's shoes, what's going through your mind other than the tremendous sense of concern. Well, what else is going through John's mind?
Fear.
Liability.
Fear, liability. What else?
Other accidents that may happen.
Other accidents that may happen. Very good. What else, though? Go back a little more fundamentally.
What do I do next?
What do I do next? What about my business? And if I step forward and say, this was my customer, we're not sure yet, but boy, we did have a big propane tank there, that my customers could flee, my own reputation and credibility could falter. So you can understand why it was a knotty situation. Now, I happen to use this case in my ethics classes down the hill because it's a great way to show right off the bat how you have to struggle with it. There's more than one right decision in a circumstance, and this was one of those. By the way, what happened in the end? And it took 4 weeks to get there, and poor John was a nervous wreck waiting these 4 weeks. But we had him sit tight. At the end of 4 weeks, it was determined that when John did the installation, and his service technician, Miguel, I'm going to pick on you, when Miguel went in to do the installation, he hooked up one furnace, one water heater, one gas dryer, and one stove in the kitchen. He had the customer sign a piece of paper that said that that's what he had done, and they took that piece of paper, and they did a gas check, by the way, make sure nothing leaked. And then he gave the customer a copy of it, took the copy back, put it in the office file. When the investigation was done, and they certainly couldn't determine it in the beginning, what they found out was that there were two furnaces, two water heaters, two gas dryers, only one stove, but someone had gone in and materially changed the scene. And it also came out near the end that the homeowner himself had done this work and had installed one of those appliances 2 days before the fire and explosion, because he was trying to turn this into a two-family home and he had not gotten a permit to do that. So in this case, John was exonerated. And I'd love to stand here and tell you that every case that I ever deal with is like that. But you know what? It's not. And sometimes the opposite occurs. And we find out that John was the one who wasn't telling the whole story, because maybe Miguel went in and did his work in the beginning, and maybe John refused to serve the customer or never did a follow-up leak check or whatever the case may be. But we had the famously called get-out-of-jail-free card of the paper that Miguel had signed and that the homeowner had signed the day of the installation. So that's a very, hi.
So Michael, what did he tell the staff? Because you made the point that it was very important that he told the staff something.
Yeah, he told the staff, in essence, and I have this formula that I use with organizations, that my messages are one page, 14-point font. It's all you're allowed. I have done billion-dollar Chapter 11 bankruptcies with organizations where they've defaulted on their pensions, everything. One page, 14-point font, that's all you get, because that's all we're capable of being able to articulate. So in his case, the messages were along the line of, and I usually number them. Number one, this morning it was a terrible tragedy on XYZ Road that happened to involve one of our customers' homes. While it's still early and we don't know a lot of details about this, and it's going to take a long time to dig through, literally, what happened here, our hearts, our thoughts, our prayers go out to the family and those that were involved in this incident. What I can tell you right now, which is also those six words have gotten me out of more trouble than any six words in my life, except with my own family, because my wife will say, don't give me that. But what I can tell you is that we're on the scene working cooperatively with fire investigators and public safety officials to try to determine what's happened here. It is way too early to suggest or to speculate what may have happened at this scene, other than to say that some type of an ignition took place. And we're committed to make sure that all of our customers are safe, because safety is our number one priority. Something along that line, which we were fully ready to hand to the news media had they shown up at the front door and said, hey, we saw your name on the tank in the backyard behind this house. This was your propane. What do you got to say for yourself? And that's not the time to say no comment. And to your point, and I'm sorry, your first name?
Irene.
To Irene's point, what we don't want to do is sensationalize things with the media, but we also have to be honest and strategic at the same time. Go ahead.
Well, those things can occasionally be in conflict with each other, but it seems like in this particular case, the press release that you mentioned that also gets you out of trouble with pretty much everybody would be an accurate statement. The problem is the cost would be that, okay, this gets spinned and can result in insinuations that have nothing to do with the truth.
Right.
So in this case, you could say both a release like that investigations are being made, and no release, as long as nobody asks, is sufficiently transparent given the circumstances. I would be, in a sense, more curious, for example, in the Flint case, or in the case where once responsibility is assigned, how do you deal with transparency then? Because a lot of debates around transparency are precisely around, you know, when we have a fairly certain attribution of responsibility or a fairly certain identification of the problem, that's when lack of transparency and dishonesty and things like that.
Okay.
Intervene.
What I'd like to do is give you a quick answer now, come back to it a little bit in a couple of slides that are coming up, and then we'll come back to it to make sure that you felt like we in fact addressed it. If this had been a situation where there was still lingering immediate risk to health and safety, let's say that this was a situation where there was a leak in a nursing home. The leak was found, but that same fuel system was connected to another wing of the nursing home and no one had bothered to check that or look at that, and there was a problem in another section. Then I would say to you that that health and safety issue, immediately somebody should do something about it, right?
Yeah.
And that probably would entail being much more public, certainly at least public with some segment of an audience. Maybe you're not going to run to the news media and say, hey, by the way, we had a problem over on, you know, North Street today. But to be more public and forward with that, absolutely. I think that in the case of Chipotle, go back to the beginning, we had to cut them a little slack for a few days. 2 or 3 weeks? I don't think so. Because the restaurants stayed open. People kept going there. As far as Flint goes, that's probably to me the most clear example of something that is, on the one hand, so extremely complicated that it was difficult to get anyone to have their arms around it, and then also so blatantly, once the facts came out, where the cover-up in fact did take place, was an example where somebody should have been much more forward, much more transparent, much earlier. Okay? So I'd like to come back to that in just a minute. Because I do think that there's an approach to this. And I like to call it kind of a systems approach. Now, I have three components for me that really lay into and are the guide for everything that I do. We'll call one, I'm going to show you a diagram called SIC, Strategy, Integrity, and Communications. The second one is mutual gains. Maybe some of you have heard that term. I'm going to talk about that. And then the third one is interest-based, and I'll bet some of you have heard from that. And that came from my friend Neil Katz. This particular one, when I started a company called Strategic Communications back in 2004, and we decided we wanted to differentiate ourselves from everybody else who was doing public relations, we wanted to say that the difference for us was that we would involve legal counsel, and we only wanted to take on the cases that were the difficult, knotty, right, the ethical-based ones that needed some work. And on the back of a napkin in a Dunkin' Donuts, I started with this diagram, started with the word strategy and communications. But the more we thought about it, the more we talked about it, that term integrity kept coming in more and more and more. And so that became kind of what I like to say the sweet spot right here where these three things come together. Aaron, you mentioned Wells Fargo, you mentioned Toyota, you mentioned... I don't know who else.
Comes down.
Yeah, right. That if we can all rattle off company names, and we could say, someday I'm going to teach a course. I want to teach this course, Lou. And this course would be that we would have a list of companies, and we would put them through some kind of a lens of a matrix of some sort of an algorithm in terms of their strategy, integrity, and communications. Because we could hear this afternoon litanize different organizations who we think had great strategy, Wells Fargo had a tremendous strategy, right? They actually even communicated it pretty well. They just lacked here. We could talk about organizations that have tremendous integrity and really communicate pretty well, but they have no idea where they're going. So it's all three of those things. It's having a good strategy, knowing where you're headed. It's being able to communicate it and having the right frame of mind with that integrity, that those things together. Many years ago, when I started working with attorneys, I'd find myself in situations where there were depositions. And so somebody might turn to Aaron and say, Aaron, do you know what time it is? And Aaron, what's your response to that?
I'll tell them the time.
Okay. Yeah. So and if I said, Aaron, do you know what time it is?
It's 1:05. Yeah.
Is that the answer to the question that I asked?
No.
No.
It's not a question. It sounds like a blame.
So the answer is
yes. Or no.
Yes. And that is, to me, the most fundamental basis of strategy. That too often, when something happens, we feel as though we need to disclose everything. One of my favorite stories about this is I had a guy that worked for me once who was a wonderful guy. He had 5 kids. And we'd go away on a business trip, and he'd come home, and they were like 8, 10, 11, 12, 15, 17 or something. And he said, all I got to do, Mike, is I show up at my dining room table at night. I sit back down. I've been gone for a couple days. Everybody's sitting around the table, and I turn to one of my kids, and I say, what's going on? And they'll spill something. They'll tell me something that they've done that they probably wouldn't have told me otherwise. The point behind this slide is simply to say to you that when we think about the dilemma of transparency, it doesn't mean that we should lie, ever. It doesn't mean that we should not tell the truth. It does mean that we should be careful about how we mete out, how we set forth what it is we're going to say about something. And I know that in and of itself is a controversial topic. Always, when these things, to go back to your question, when these things are immediately at risk, there should be no question. We shouldn't be fooling around with whether we should answer the question about do you know what time it is. We should be making sure that everybody knows exactly what time it is. The second one, or before we get to the second one, there's this idea of reaction and response. And I certainly had dealt with enough situations where there were either medical emergencies or fires or explosions or evacuations or hazardous materials. We had, at Agway, we had 3,850 trucks on the road, and my responsibility and one of the jobs I had was to make sure that everybody was safe. Well, we were transporting feed and fertilizer and food products, but we were also transporting a lot of gasoline and propane and heating oil. So that's where I earned every one of my gray hairs. We have to remember what our natural tendency is when something happens. And that is, we have this instinct, we have this fight or flight, we have this knee-jerk reaction, I like to call it. When really what we need to do is think more about hitting the pause button and being a little bit more systematic with how we respond to things. There's, in ethics, I talk about teleological, so utilitarianism, what's the greatest good for the greatest number of people? Or in fact, utility, what's the greatest good for me? Both of which are based on what the consequences are that we determine are likely to occur at the outcome of a response, whatever we do. Then there's the deontological approach, that's Immanuel Kant, and that's all about I have a sense of duty. So, right, so Nate, who's in the military, took an oath, and he knows exactly what that means and what that requires of him. He has a deontological decision-making approach to much of what he does for the Air Force. Neither one nor the other is the right one all the time, but to at least understand them and then utilize them when you go about making a difficult decision allows you to make what Jeffrey Siegelin at Harvard would say is the best right decision. Okay? And I always tell everybody, whether it's a student or a client, that we have to understand what considerations are, all the considerations, what the consequences might be, and then what your obligations are, because they all feed into this. And then that allows us, by touching the pause button, to be a little bit more objective, so that when somebody calls me at 7 o'clock in the morning to tell me about something that I have to visualize of a house exploded to smithereens, we think about what steps we take to go forward. The mutual gains approach I mentioned, I saw a couple of heads nod. If you've never seen the book, it's old now. It's 20 years old, but it's a great book. I actually spent 2 weeks at Harvard with Larry Susskind and Pat Field. And I would suggest to you that this probably changed my view of transparency and changed my view of how to approach the kinds of knotty situations I deal with more than anything else ever. And as I said, it's 20 years old now. Basically, the mutual gains approach has 6 components. And I think that when back to the question of what do you do in a situation when things are very tense and we need to respond, we need to react, especially where health and safety are concerned, it's acknowledging concerns. Sometimes people don't do that because they're afraid that if they acknowledge their concern that they're already subject to all kinds of liability. When in fact, that can be done with grace and with courtesy and with responsibility. Encourage fact-finding, right? Offer contingent commitments, and I've got a visual on this. Accept responsibility where you can. That doesn't mean that you have to accept all the blame, but to in fact accept responsibility, especially for the action that's going to be taken from this day forward, can make a big difference. Act in a trustworthy fashion, which really just means that you live up to your commitments. If you're going to make some kind of a commitment, then make sure you live up to it. And these are usually incremental. When I get involved in a case, whether it's either a public health case, whether it's the union negotiation in another state, it's all about making a commitment and then following through on it. And this is basic stuff, folks. You know this stuff. It's the all I ever needed to know I learned in kindergarten stuff. It's the under-promise, over-deliver stuff. And then focus on the long term for where you're trying to go. And if we were to visualize this, we would kind of, from a continuum standpoint, look at this. And you'll notice that there's a spot here in which as we begin to earn some trust, that's when we can go back and offer more commitments, take more actions, assume more responsibility, and then that enables us to build that long-term relationship. So that is the approach that I use with almost everything I do. And I'm going to give you an example. I took Larry's course right after the book came out, 1996. I came back to Agway. And at that time, I had 5 different buckets of responsibilities. And one of those buckets was all the environmental engineers for the company reported to me, which was kind of a scary thought because I am not an engineer. As an oil company, we had 500,000 customers. When you said, Aaron, that I had 500,000, I don't have 500,000 clients. We had 500,000 customers at Agway one time. I wish I could say that I had 500,000 customers. We would typically, because we were an oil company, stuff happens. It wouldn't be unusual for us, and this wasn't an everyday occurrence, but to put a nozzle for an oil truck into somebody's basement pipe, thinking it was going into their tank, when it went into their floor. This happened. And until this day, when I came back all full of great ideas, what our response was when this would happen would be to disconnect the pipe or the tank, right? Disconnect the hose, put it back in the truck, tell the customer there's a problem, there's some oil in their basement, and drive away. And wait for the attorneys to call. Wow. And have our attorneys, of which we had some on staff and some that were, you know, there's the in-house attorneys and then there's outhouse attorneys. That's a joke. Wait for the phone to ring because we're going to set aside a reserve and expect that we're going to be paying something out. Whereas I used to like to say we're going to be buying a house someplace. So on this particular day when this one happened and I was notified about it, I had me walking by a conference room where there were a bunch of people on a conference call right around a table like this. And I stuck my head in and said, what's going on? They said, we've had an oil spill in New Jersey. And we've put some oil in somebody's basement. How much? 300 gallons. Okay. Keep me posted on all the facts. The attorneys are on the phone. The district manager from New Jersey is on the phone. Everybody else. And I started walking down the hallway. And I got about halfway down the hallway. And I stopped. And I said, wait a minute. And I turned around and I came back and I said, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to do this one differently. Where's the family right now? I don't know. Well, I can only imagine what that house is like if it's full of 300 gallons of oil. So Eric, I want you to call them, and I want you to tell them to find the nicest hotel nearby and make sure it's got a meal service. And I want you to get them two rooms, because I knew that they had two kids already from what they told me. I want them to get them two rooms for as long as they need. And Eric is already wondering about that, and his attorney, Christine, is saying, hold on a minute, I'm not done yet. Then what I want to do is I want to get the engineers, I want you guys to go down there, and I want you to assess what's the cost to fix this and fix it right. And let's get an estimate in the next 48 hours. And get that on my desk, because we're gonna go about this one differently. And then, Miguel, you're one of our attorneys as well on the outside that represents us, and you always tell us to reserve this amount of money, what the defense costs would be. I'd like an estimate from you. You've done enough of these for us. So I want to know how much it's going to cost if we do it the way we usually do it. And I want that information in 48 hours. In 48 hours, got everybody back together again, and we determined it was going to cost about $180,000 or $190,000 to dig up this basement, to start all over again, to replace all the equipment. Half the basement was finished, and do everything right. It would have cost us $100,000 to $150,000 in attorney's fees to defend it, and some unknown number to settle it. And I said, let's try doing something different. 6 months later, we kept the customer. It cost us $210,000 when we were done. But to me, that was a mutual gains approach. I'm leaving all the steps out in between, but that's a different way to look at how to get things done. So I just want you to know that on the one hand, I might be saying to John, the propane guy, don't necessarily say anything just yet. But on the other hand, when we know that we're at fault for something, we should jump in it right away. Irene, you're shaking your head, nodding your head, you're going crazy.
You're killing me over here with this explanation. I don't know, just understanding what it is once you're involved with attorneys and the rules and the trade-offs. And I will share a brief anecdote from the last week. I committed a major faux pas and communicated with the defense's counsel, at which point my attorney, I'm involved in a foreclosure lawsuit as the plaintiff, my attorney immediately contacted me and said, I can't believe this, and I'm questioning whether or not I'm going to drop you as a client. So I guess I just share that. I love how you handle this. It's wonderful to hear. That said, it's difficult because there are so many factors. I mean, for one, you had deep pockets. So you were in a position that you could do the ethical thing and you could approach it from a different standpoint. Secondarily, there was a history of conducting it differently. So you didn't have to pitch a new idea. You had something to compare it to as already, you know, played out.
Sure.
And then this was a trial episode. Like, there are just so many aspects to that. And you said so yourself, you were at fault. So
yeah.
That's another aspect. I just, personally, I'm struggling because in my particular circumstance, I would like to directly engage the other side, but there's...
It doesn't work in everything.
No.
and I had the distinct advantage that everybody around the table worked for me. And the person on the outside, the outhouse attorney also worked for me. So sometimes it's a matter of taking control. Now, I've had others that haven't gone this well, but I'd have one. If we had more time, I'd love to talk to you about Destiny USA. I'd love to say, no, really, it's a good story. But let's talk about this one. Now, I can't get into a lot of the details of this because of a confidentiality agreement, but the public things that you know, when the fall of 2015, when Legionella was discovered in the water system at St. Joseph's, there were many hours of conversation about how forthright to be. And what I can tell you, right, is that Kathy Resido, no matter what anybody might think about her, I was in Canada teaching. It was a Friday. It was October 23rd, 2015. If you look it up, I think that's going to be the date. It was either the 22nd or the 23rd. I got a call from her at 4 o'clock in the afternoon to tell me this had happened. And by 6 a.m., we had a note to every news outlet. We had something to every employee. We had notes to families and patient family members. There was a whole different way to do this. Now, this took months to sort through. But this was another organization that at least that time, I won't say every time, that time took the mutual gains approach. Now, I mentioned getting, yes, has anybody read this book? It is phenomenal. And I tell every student I've ever had that if you never read another book, read this book, because it'll help you negotiate your first salary. It'll help you negotiate your relationship with your significant other. It'll help you develop a better relationship with your boss or your coworker. I live by this interest-based negotiation. And that's why I say that the three of these things together are what I think make the difference. Because if I just used one or the other, I may or may not hit a brick wall. So the question, how transparent should we be? I don't know. If you looked at the 2017 Edelman Trust Barometer, and if you're interested in that at all, just jot that down and go out and Google it. It's pretty fascinating. Basically says, and they have one slide that shows the last 16 years, I think, that trust is now in crisis. And I'm not here to dispute that. So if I made you think or stirred you up a little bit, then good. Your turn. Oh, one other thing. Two other books you ought to read. Rules of Civility by George Washington. I've been reading that lately and I love it. It's fascinating. It's also kind of funny. But this is his view when he was taught as a young man how to behave in the world. It really comes back from a French book in the 16th century. And Thomas Paine's Common Sense. Both of those, pretty interesting compared to this subject. I don't know why they just sort of fell off my shelf as I was thinking about getting ready for this. Sorry, go ahead.
Patrick, were you going to ask the question you asked in class? That's personnel decisions.
No.
Let's do it.
I'm going to ask your question.
Please do.
We are in a class together on HR management.
Mm-hmm.
And the question was, how do you handle transparency in terms of personnel decisions, which you're not supposed to be transparent from a legal point of view? On the other hand, in many cases, people know what's going on. Or they're waiting to see how management handles it. So you've got a whole organization out there, and you're not saying it.
It's a tough one. Tomorrow, actually Monday, in my next ethics class, I've got a clip about leveling with employees. Jeffrey Siegel from Harvard. I have several of his clips. He's a good friend. And I think that one of the biggest mistakes that managers make, to take it right down to the real basic level, is that it's not what they do or don't say, it's that they do or don't listen. And if you think about that, especially the men in the room would understand this because our wives and daughters are always telling us we try to fix everything and we need to just listen to them as opposed to trying to fix everything. If an employee comes to you and wants to vent about the fact that you fired Aaron, right? That Aaron's no longer here, that Aaron is separated from the company, let's be, right? Because you aren't even going to say you fired him. But that Aaron is no longer here. He's gone to pursue other opportunities. We've all seen that phrase. Quite often what we need to do that we're afraid to do is because we know we can't say anything because of legal, and that's absolutely true, we don't want to listen. And if we would just listen, the venting might come out to the point, and I mean listen, I mean like be present to somebody, then we might find that the person who's venting to you can kind of almost come to their own conclusion without us having to say anything. And that's hard to do. But reflective listening, everybody know what that is? Many of you do. If you don't, look it up, because it's pretty powerful. So that, to me, would probably be the most important thing. I cannot get a group of employees together and say, well, everybody knows Aaron's no longer with us, so let me tell you why. I can't do that.
So you've got a whole institution of people, the grapevine's going crazy.
That's not to say I wouldn't get everybody together and say, you know, Aaron is not here anymore. I cannot comment on the specifics of that.
Okay.
But what I can tell you is that and then I need to be truthful about if Aaron did certain things here that were valuable to us, then I'm going to say that. We wish him well. I can't discuss anything else related to that. I'd like to listen to you, and let's talk about what we do going forward.
Okay.
That's different.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, I think this is there are many very interesting examples that we could debate at length. But just in this specific, the latest specific example that Catherine brought up, there are good reasons not to comment on individual cases, including privacy reasons, for example, right? Erin, I'm sure, has a right to the privacy about her own case or issues like that. But you can comment about the principles on which hiring and firing are done. And it's a different kind of transparency than commenting on individuals' cases, right? I was actually thinking all those examples, they're very interesting, but it's a kind of incidental transparency, right? So we have specific incidents where image needs to be managed, and how do we best manage our image while being as transparent as possible and desirable.
So let's get real practical. Aaron got fired because he mismanaged the department budget. He didn't break the law, he didn't commit a crime, but he mismanaged the department budget, and it's a shambles. And so Catherine fired him.
Okay.
Handle that. What would you say about it?
Well, if people really want to know, I would say yes, he mismanaged. But you have to have an explanation for what.
Because he's got an agreement signed with her for separation to make sure he's going to get his health insurance for the next couple months and at least a month's pay, or depending on how long he's been with us, that says that neither he nor he can talk about this.
Okay, then the official answer, we cannot talk about this, but here are the principles and the expectations we have for our staff for their performance, right? That's what I'm saying, it's a different kind of transparency. So I'm not saying in this specific instance, not talking about it or talking about this is necessarily the right decision. What I'm trying to say is, if we're asking how transparent should we be, the first step is to define transparency, right? And to say what we mean about transparency. And there's different kinds that we can talk about, right? There's transparency in specific instances, like the concrete practical examples that we've discussed. But there's principles of transparency that are also translated, for example, into company policy, right? So at how do we communicate the expectations to our staff about performance, right? If there are things that we can contractually and legally not talk about, that should be acknowledged, but still, and to some degree, take also into account what kind of information staff, stakeholders, the community, legislators, all everybody involved needs for their decisions and for their levels of stress. So this is not a critique, this is me trying to kind of...
No, this is good.
Broaden the discussion in a sense.
Yeah, because quickly what I would say is that if Catherine's company had a code of conduct and business ethics guidebook, then the appropriate thing to do would be remind everybody of what's in that. Not just about financial management, but about just to be familiar with all those things and to be aware of them, and then leave it at that. Because even if you were to stand up and say that mismanagement of company funds is a pretty important thing to us and we just want you to know, wink, wink, nod, nod, that enough could be enough to get her in legal trouble. So she can't even say that. But good. I'd like to have coffee with you. We could arm wrestle. Yes.
No. I'd rather talk, but okay.
I want to apologize to begin with by bringing up our present presidential situation. Could you say something publicly about transparency and what is very good about this is that it's not always good, but it has a value. And how do you do that when the President of the United States says that EPA employees cannot give out any information about anything except what comes through his office? That is so outrageous. I don't understand why every academic and every institution in this country isn't screaming. Could you moderate that?
You know, I went through all last semester and only a week this year so far, but I have said that I won't talk about politics at all in any of my classrooms. But I'm not in a classroom.
Not in the classroom, but I'll.
All right, let's have at it. My biggest concern, I didn't vote for the man. My biggest concern with him is this. I can live with just about any other policy debate decision that he might want to put forward. But this is what I have trouble with. Now, there's my political statement. Sorry for those of you that don't feel that way. I had to get that off my chest. And fasten your seatbelt with what I'm about to say. And I'm not in the news area, right? I'm in Newhouse, but I'm not in journalism. My best friend is the chair of the newspaper department. I actually think what's going on with Trump, I feel like Stephen Colbert when I say it again, that what's going on with Trump is going to change forever the media. And it's going to change forever, and maybe change for the good, what the media ultimately does. They're not doing it yet, but I think what they're ultimately going to do. And that's a dangerous, I just lit a firecracker by making that statement. So in that sense, I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. Now, if I were a news reporter, I would, I'd be wanting to wrestle that one to the ground. As far as his sense of transparency and muzzling, like EPA and the agencies, I read the Washington Post article this morning. I feel like at least this is just me, you may disagree, I feel like I need to read more to understand exactly what he's doing. Because buried in an article I read this morning, it said that when Obama came in for the first couple of weeks, he shut everybody down too and said, nobody does anything right now till we figure out. And I think for those of us, and I'm just pointing at me, who is predisposition to not care for this guy, that, and my, if you think I'm, you see my wife, is that to look at something like that and say, aha, see, he's doing it again. Whereas I think what we need to do is consume the news as broadly and evenly keeled as we can, and just wait a little bit. Not a long time, but a little bit. But I need to hit the pause button on that too. I hear you. I hear you. And maybe somebody else would like to comment on that.
Not comment on that. A more general question. Do you think that there is a greater expectation of transparency today than there has been in the past? And if so, how should organizations react?
The answer to your first question is absolutely, Eric. And I think probably the mere fact that aside from, and I don't know what your first name is,
Tom
recording us here, and Rachel taking some photographs, anybody else could be recording us in this room, and they could do so legally right now. So who knows? You're always on. Isn't it amazing when you watch the news how somebody's got a picture of everything? Mm-hmm. I mean, how we see videos of everything? So we live in a world where that's happening now everywhere. And so the expectation for transparency is so much higher. I have a student at McMaster, a master's student that just completed her capstone, her master's degree in freedom of information laws and how they apply. Now, she lives in Canada. Of course, I'm always kidding her about that. But they have the same issues. And some of her cases, if you think some of the case studies I threw out were interesting, you should hear what hers are, because she's got a board, a municipal board, that has been threatened, has been challenged by the news media because they won't release every single conversation that this board ever has. And what worries me about that, the fact that things are so much more transparent and the demand is and it's so much more accessible, is that for you and I to have any kind of a professional conversation that is even a little bit private to debate, just as we were debating how to handle something, that some might say that should all be publicized. And that's ridiculous. Because we need to have that debate so that we can then come forward with what we think is the unified position or the position of our representation that we've got there. We want to respond to Eric or to me?
I didn't mean to interrupt.
That's fine. Go ahead.
No, but this is, in a sense, to both of you, I mean, to that question, and also to Luz, I think that the thing that I'm trying to get at here, and I would like to hear your thoughts on, is okay, full disclosure is not always desirable. It can be harmful. So I agree with you that saying that everybody should disclose everything all of the time is just ridiculous. But my question is a little bit, so how do we come up with a set of rules and principles about when to be transparent or not, right? Because this is the question that I understand guides the discussion. So I'd like to hear your thoughts on this.
I think it starts here. Mm-hmm. I have to understand what my strategy is. Now, okay. This isn't about morality. This is about what my strategy is. If I was in the military and my strategy was to take the hill, then that's where my focus is. How I communicate about taking the hill and how I make sure that... And integrity doesn't always mean that everyone's going to like what you do, but it also means that that there's an honesty about it. So it starts there, to me. And only if I have a really clear understanding of that can I then get into using this model.
Okay, but this model doesn't tell you when to be transparent or not. It tells you how to deal with potential crisis, right? That's the way I understand it.
So what you're saying is that this doesn't make the decision ethically about when and how much?
More or less, yeah. So it is a strategic decision about, you know, is it good or is it bad for me to be transparent, right? But there are decisions that should not about when to be transparent or not that are ethical in nature. And I think, for example, the question about, you know, politics or businesses, how much should they disclose to the public as a principle? That's situation independent. That's based on a set of principles on when to be transparent or not. And this is kind of what I was
good
trying
question.
To get at.
No, that's a very good question. Probably what's indicative here that I don't have as a separate step, and maybe I should, is this idea of, and I mentioned teleological versus deontological decision making. Are you familiar with that? Because it's worth reading up on because it changed how I view things.
Yeah.
In other words, if I have an action that maybe my action is I'm trying to decide, Eric's come to me because he works for me and the company I've been told is going to have layoffs in 3 weeks. And while I don't have his name on the list yet, there's a pretty good chance he could lose his job. But I don't know that. And also, my boss, Miguel, said to me, you can't tell anybody that we're going to do layoffs. Why? Because it could threaten our market share. Our employees could all leave. There's all kinds of reasons why we can't say that yet. So he has put that on me. Eric shows up in my office the next day and says, hey, my wife and I are thinking about buying our first house. Is there any reason why I shouldn't do that right now?
Okay, so if I...
No, but hang on. How I handle what I'm going to say to him is what you're trying to get at.
Yeah.
And to me, well, it is. It's how do I decide whether I'm going to say to him, A, Eric, or Eric, you'll be fine. Or Eric, I can't tell you anything right now. And that decision process that falls here, I believe, for me comes down to testing that thing. Do I tell him? That transparency, do I tell him? I test that with utilitarianism, which is a 9-step process. I test that with utility, which is pretty much a 1-step process, which is just looking out for me. That's it. And I also test that with my deontological view, which is duty, and that's a 5-step process. I know you're looking at me, what do you mean by 5 steps? They're relatively straightforward, but in order for me to think about, do I have a sense of duty to him? And duty, by the way, is exercised without regard for consequences. Someone who takes an oath has that oath, and they are compelled to act if they choose to act upon duty, regardless of what their consequences. So if I decide that my sense of duty to Eric, because I've known him for 35 years and our kids grew up together and everything else, and he's just buying a house, that I feel like I need to tell him that, then I am disregarding the consequences that I've gone against my boss. It will probably cost me my job, and Eric may still lose his job as well. Those are the consequences, but I've disregarded them. If I think about utilitarianism, and I think about the greatest good for the greatest number, and I go through these 9 steps, and it starts to make me think about, are there all alternatives? What are the good results, the possible bad results, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It takes away the knee-jerk reaction of just instinctively saying, the right thing to do is to be transparent, doesn't matter what. Does it help a little?
Kind of. I think my conclusion from your description, so yeah, every situation can be judged by competing ethics criteria, right?
Yeah.
And in every situation, then you have to make a decision that is situation-specific about which of those criteria should prevail, so
right,
to say,
right.
Including judging the consequences of your action based on, you know, utilitarian principles, so to say. I'm going to leave it at that.
No, it's great. Good. Very good. Did you?
Yeah, I just ran to this conversation from reading an article about consequentialism. That is the same thing that you've been discussing, and that morality is measured against the consequence. That it so the means are the ends
justify the means.
The means in some sense. And I think that to think of in a utopian ethical manner, I think that what you're saying makes a lot of sense, because the world of politics and the world of business is governed by is most of the time choosing between right and right. So if it is about choosing between right and wrong, it would be easy to decide what to do. But there are two rights. Firing a person and preserving the company is a right, and also the salary and the life, the family life of that person is right. So I think, yes, it's not that easy to decide. And most of the time is the consequence of what we do is what make it.
Yeah, thank you for that, because the whole area of consequentialism, which fits right into that slide of processing through the teleological versus the ontological view, is exactly that. It's determining, do the consequences matter? Think about, I always tell the story, it was a basketball game last night, and I will tell the story about a guy I used to know who always was trying to leverage my relationship with him to get tickets to a basketball game. Now, that's not treating someone as an ends in of themselves. That's treating them as a means to an end. And what we're trying to do, and what Kant says, is we're trying to make sure that we treat people as an ends in and of themselves, that there's a universality approach to this. And sometimes the only way I can do that is to answer the question to Eric, when he says, do you think I should buy this house? Eric, I can't tell you. I can't give you, and I have to have that poker face. It's much back to Aaron's no longer with us, and I'm telling everybody as a group that Aaron's no longer with us, and Aaron did a lot of good things while he was here, and I personally will miss Aaron, that he's going to be gone. And I can't discuss the reasons or the circumstances around which Aaron had to leave here, but we wish him the best. And I need us all to kind of pull together and understand and respect that we need to keep quiet about that.
But even that comment implies some
happiness. That's as close that I would come to it as anything.
If he really mismanaged the company's funds, do you really wish him the best?
Well, if he's going to find himself with some criminal activity, that'll take care of itself. And if
okay.
I had another case recently where somebody embezzled... I got to be careful how much I say, because it was in the news, but you don't even know about it here. There's a prominent person that was hired in Central New York in the last 6 months. What's that? did you say a name?
I said an organization.
No. And that person's spouse is in prison for embezzling $35 million. And so the question became, how much should be said about the spouse, not the one in jail, the one here, who has been, had no connection whatsoever to anything.
I think we have probably one last intervention on that.
Yeah, come on, but I've spoken already, so I don't know if someone else.
Okay, maybe we can have those last two then.
No, I don't have one.
Oh, you
can. All right, just brief comments, I suppose. One is that, is it Sabine? I don't catch your name. Yes?
Sabina, yes.
Sabina. One of the things that I thought of, and I don't know that it helps either resolve your concerns, but I think that generally the question of transparency does have to do with who you're being transparent to. So who is the ultimate party that you're disclosing or not disclosing to? Is it the society at large? Is it employees? Is it a spouse? I just think that's a relevant consideration, because when you're trying to come up with some sort of ethical standard, I think who, that matters, that's one thing. The other thing, I think tied to that is this question, rules of civility. I think answering that question has to do with what is being civil, whether it be societally or family relationships or employee-employer or what have you. So just some thoughts.
I, I don't have all the answers, and I don't claim to be good at this. I'm trying to get better at understanding how to manage this. All I know is that for my career, which I'm kind of on the downward side of now, it's been fun to be the one who says, let me get into the ring and handle those really knotty, difficult. It's a lot more fun than doing the plain stuff.
I bet.
Yeah. So thanks for your time. Sorry to hold you late. Sorry to make you stay late.
So.